terrestrial family member, I filled the need with an imaginary creature from outer space. And E.T. was really about the divorce of my parents. E.T. is also a movie that I probably get questioned about the most from young kids who always ask me, when are you going to make a sequel to E.T.? And I always say, I'm not, unfortunately. I'm sorry, I'm not going to. But I thought, oh my God, wouldn't it be great to reissue it? And what better occasion than the 20th anniversary to bring it back out again with a couple of enhancements to sort of, you know, please the perfectionist inside myself. E.T. is really the same picture. It's been enhanced by the current technology, which I would have used had I had that technology in 1981. And the whole digital technology allowed me to take 50 of my pet peeve shots and correct them digitally. I'd always wanted to get rid of E.T.'s run at the beginning of the film when Keyes is chasing him, because E.T. was simply a light on a rail. Now you see E.T. actually running fast, and you realize, oh, these things can run.
Valenzuela.
I met Steven when I was 9 years old. I had come out to LA for the first time. I was from San Antonio, Texas. That's where I was living. And I came out to Universal and had an audition.
And I said, let's make something up. It's an improvisation.
There's a knock on your door and a man comes in, a grown man, not your brother. And he's from NASA.
I just said that you have a best friend. And this is a creature. It's a best creature friend. And there is a man that's going to come in to your house, and he's going to be from the government, and he's going to try to get you to give this friend of yours back to him. And Henry, whatever you have to do, you stop him.
Now, young man, I understand that you have an alien somewhere in this house. Is that true?
And Mike Fenton, the casting director, played the government man.
Well, is it true?
You can't take him.
Well, I'm afraid I have to, son.
Can't take him away, he's mine!
But it's not my choice. The president asked me to come here and get him.
I don't care what the president says, he's my best friend. And you can't take him away!
And I got the part. It was the fastest auditioning process I've ever been on.
Okay, kid, you got the job.
And action!
Michael!
Get the bikes. Meet us at the playground at the top of the hill.
Robert was sort of the typical teenager, you know, in the picture. You know, he was always torturing and teasing his brother the way I'm certainly, you know, guilty as charged of teasing my sisters growing up.
How you feeling, Faker?
I'm feeling fine. Look.
So I put a lot of myself into Robert's character. I put myself in all the characters, but I remember specifically Robert, you know, where the hand comes in and
he came back. Oh, my God!
That stuff that I did to my sisters to just make them nuts when I was growing up.
Okay, now, swear it. The most excellent promise you can make.
I had a real close relationship with Henry, and I felt almost sort of protective of him. We did a lot of stuff off the set as far as, like, you know, playing Dungeons and Dragons. And then Drew, we sort of treated her like the baby sister, just like you see in the movie with the torturing the doll. And she was always trying to get our attention. She was the cutest little thing.
I was six, and I was just incredibly, like, aware at that time. I feel like I remember everything as if it was yesterday.
90 and 90 is 100?
Let me stand up and let's take
a look. Oh, yeah. I thought 50 and 50 was 100.
90 and 90.
Drew was the first person I hired on the movie, and I had met a lot of possible Gerties. But when Drew came in and began to tell me that she was a punk rock and roll band leader. She's 6 years old. She's telling me she has a punk band.
I told him I had a band called the Purple People Eaters, and I was the drummer. And he just empowered me to believe that, sure, if I wanted to be in a punk rock band, I could certainly be in a punk rock band.
I said, you know, I could use that imagination in this picture. She could help me make my movie better. I thought she was one of the most remarkable children I had ever met. And I immediately, you know, hired her.
He's really real.
The wire, all the wires.
These aren't wires, those are his feet.
Hey, Andy, how do you feel? What happened in here?
Steven's an incredible director. He would take the time to find out how we each work the best. And fortunately for all of us, I worked the best the same way the kids did. When I didn't know what was coming, when we didn't rehearse it very much, when I was just in the moment. So it was all very easy. You know, you cast the right people, you trust them.
He doesn't look too good anymore.
Don't say that, we're fine.
What's all this we stuff?
You say we all the time now.
I read the script. They sent a messenger up. I'd never had that experience. And he sat in my living room while I read the script. And then he took it and he went back. And I got it.
But his being here is a miracle, Elliot. It's a miracle.
I knew what it was saying. I knew what it was about. And I wanted to be in it. Of course, I knew Steven Spielberg. And, you know, I'm only seen from the waist down for half of it. But I just have always felt that when great directors call you, you just gamble with them. You know, you just, if they're gonna jump off a cliff, you jump off the cliff. And I felt that way about Spielberg.
That whole day was supposed to feel like he at home with his new best friend.
Elliot.
And it's a very short day without that scene.
5 pounds.
But with the inclusion of that scene, there is a little more bonding opportunities for E.T. and Elliot to get to know each other.
It must be around... What is it? Aren't you dirty?
E.T. was absolutely real to me. I understood that it took mechanics and some people being in his suit and a woman doing his hands to make him manifest and come alive, but I just thought that he was a guardian angel, very real to me, and a good friend. He was a very real, tangible being.
It was tough writing a good look for E.T. because I wanted E.T. to be special. I didn't want him to look like aliens from other movies.
He was a farmer. He's an agricultural worker. He's a drone. You know, he's out collecting, but their affinity was to plant life. So then we sort of thought there had to be sort of a squishy, earthy, muddy kind of feeling about him.
At the beginning, we tried a whole bunch of different kinds of things. We tried a bunch of different kinds of heads.
And I began working first with Ed Vereau, and Ed did a lot of sketches of E.T., a couple of which are pretty interesting precursors to what Carlo Rambaldi came up with. I brought Carlo on board because Carlo had worked with me on Close Encounters, and he began to work on E.T. in clay.
I make 3 little models in clay with little different anatomical point, one skin, one little fat, another, etc., with different dimension of the face. With Spielberg, we clarify what is the best. And I have just 3 months time for finish everything.
Ouch.
Healing was something that came up pretty early. Actually, I remember that I asked kids what superpower they would want, either to have themselves or to have this man from outer space to have. And healing came up a lot, that he could take care of hurts.
1, 3, 1, 2, 3.
No! No! And Michael screams, say no to Michael.
No!
The whole premise of the film hinged upon that believability.
Cut, great. Beautiful.
And that's why it was so important for Steven to really get the look down for E.T., get the design down to where people could believe that it wasn't just a guy in a suit. That's why the eyes were so important and why we did a lot of takes of E.T. enunciating the words correctly with 12 guys working in unison.
E.T. phone home.
Faster.
E.T. phone home.
E.T. phone home.
If we had a pile of rubber there, you know, just pulsating and blinking a lot, and I wasn't emoting anything, it wouldn't have worked.
As we went on, you could see more and more of E.T., but in the beginning, it was essential that he be very mysterious, that he stay very much in the dark. He would have a backlight. There would be something that would just give a reflection in his eyes and a little bit of shape to his face. Every scene started with the same question, where is he going to be? Because the mechanical E.T., he'd have to be anchored to the floor. Our sets were all raised on a structure so that the cables could be snaked around out of the set without having to cross the floor, so that we would literally have a hole drilled. E.T. would go in that, the cables would run out and go to the operators. And the operators viewed E.T. most of the time via remote video cameras so they could see what he was doing. And their sense of synchronization had to be so perfect.
We had a beautiful mime artist doing E.T.'s hands, so the hands were really brought E.T. to life. But there was no real movement, full movement of E.T., except when we had the little people and our young boy without legs inside the E.T. costume, especially for the scene inside the kitchen where he gets hit by the refrigerator, hits the wall, and falls over drunk.
There's a hole!
Down from the hole, but I think you killed him already.
In altering him, we were trying to stay with the E.T. that we had created. That really dictated an attitude toward what these changes would be like.
It was kind of like giving E.T. cosmetic surgery. In order to give him more expression, there had to be more digital movement in the face. Therefore, ILM had to create more muscles that were never in evidence when we made the picture with the limitations of the technology, of the state of the art.
So if we were to do E.T. again, I would say that we would probably do some combination of computer graphics and an animatronic character.
Violation.
This experience of work was one of the greatest I've ever had in my whole life. Absolute pleasure. Going to work was fun. We'd have so much fun. We dressed up for Halloween.
Will somebody cheer up Drew Barrymore,
please? Drew, here we go. Drew, come on.
When Harpo's back, Dick Nixon, let me see the profile. Look at Steven.
Aren't you supposed to be working? Would you turn around and do your work, please?
We'd go to school together, and all of this was a part of life, being led by this man who was my father figure, Steven, who believed in us so much that it was like going to sleep was like just getting through it so you could wake up and go back to that warmth and safe environment again. And then the fact that you not only get to play, but express yourself so much and be creative, and it was just the most perfect experience.
One of the things that really helped all the kids and helped the crew was the fact that I insisted on shooting the film in complete continuity. So the kids knew emotionally where they had been the day before, and they pretty much didn't have any idea where they were going the next day. So like real life, every day was a surprise. And until finally, when E.T. began to die, Drew, Henry Thomas, and Robert really believed that this was happening to their lives. And I think their acting couldn't even be called acting at that point. It was just reacting.
We're losing them.
It was reacting to their best friend in the universe who was going away and leaving them.
I don't know how to feel anymore.
Right, exactly. That's a good line.
I can't feel.
Thank you.
In the case where your co-star is inanimate and made of plastic, obviously he's not going to be giving you a lot off screen. So Steven would quite often talk me through the scene and tell me what was happening off screen that I was reacting to.
Look at the heart light.
E.T. phone home. E.T. phone home.
Is this
home?
Yeah.
Does this mean they're coming?
Yes.
And so when I saw the film for the first time, I was convinced that I was hearing Steven's voice over and over and over again. But of course it wasn't there. But I imagined that it was.
I was very, very sensitive to the fact that there were guns in E.T.
We made it!
I had put the guns in E.T. I wanted there to be an adult threat against the kids. But just having the guys with the guns anywhere around the kids always bothered me. And I felt that the guns were probably an inappropriate thing to do, and those guys could have easily been with walkie-talkies. So I thought this was an opportunity to take out the guns. I was very careful not to change the substance of the story, not to change any of the characters or any of what motivates them to arrive together at the end. These are just like taking a very, very fine paintbrush and just putting a little bit of rouge on a pallid face.
One of my personal goals on the project was to make sure that the effects are the way that people remember them, for them not to stand out. That it just flow and have the charm that the original did, and I think we succeeded. I think that when people go to see this, unless they're educated ahead of time about what we changed, they're not gonna notice it. And they shouldn't, because what they're gonna go to see is the film, not the updated effects.
He is the cutest alien I have ever met and seen.
I would like every film I've ever made revisited in movie theaters, and I wanted it just to give the audience a reason to see it.
With enhanced visual effects, never before seen footage, and a digitally remastered soundtrack.
You know, DTS, digitally enhanced soundtrack, they never heard it in stereo before. Johnny's music is more spectacular than ever in the film now with the spread of the sound.
When he takes off, even though what's on the screen is one of the most silliest temps I've ever seen.
I think it's thrilling that people get to see it again in a theater, because this is a communal experience movie. That's why it was successful, is because you shared it with everybody around you. And for, you know, 2 hours, you were friends.
Just a rehearsal. Action. Yeah.
The whole movie all in was $10 million. Universal wanted to make the picture, but they thought it would lose a lot of money because it was a kids' movie, and kids' movies were not doing well. And I understand their hesitation. No kid movie had broken through any kind of a ceiling for years. So I was happily in shock when it began to roll out the way it did. I never pretended that E.T. would succeed. So I didn't make E.T. with tremendous visions of grandeur. I just wanted to get the movie made. It was very close to my heart. I had to see that picture come to fruition. And everything else was icing on the cake. It's just a beautiful time to all be getting back together again. And you know, I feel as familiar with this group as I felt in 1981. It's funny how 20 years isn't really that long of a time.
I hadn't been in the movie business very long, so it's not as though I had a huge track record of reading a lot of screenplays, but I have to say that it was clearly an incredibly special story, and now that I look back 20 years, I recognize just how rare it was, and it was in perspective pretty incredible.
I truly never thought of E.T. as a puppet. He was very real to all of us. You really have to understand that he was. And I felt like the mom. who is one of the kids.
Oh, my God.
Drew.
The 80s was a turbulent time also. And I always thought that one of the things that made people love this film was if two people or three people as far apart as E.T. and those children could bridge a gap and fall in love with one another and communicate, then there were no two people on Earth that were that far apart. There are no two cultures that were that far apart.
The best moment of all was seeing it for the first time in a theater with an audience and feeling the overwhelming emotion that was pouring out of this audience. It was really one of the most amazing moments in my life.
It just showed me that there are no boundaries with people and in life, and that the world is a very big place filled with beautiful people, and it made me a better person. It made me so much of who I am today.
We won!
I'd seen a sneak preview somewhere before the release date, and then I went back to my home and I felt like I had this great secret, you know? Because it was secret. We weren't allowed to talk about it all that much. But I remember riding my bike around my hometown and humming the theme in my head and just being like, yeah. You know? I can't wait for this to hit.
That's great.
Okay, and
okay.
Roll.
Rolling.
Now. Cut.
Where are we going?
To the forest!
I think people are looking for films that don't remind them of the troubled times we live in, but can allow them to make that ultimate journey of pure escape. And E.T., I think, certainly will have a little more impact because of that. It's a cliche now to say this movie is for the child in all of us. No, this movie is for the people we are and the people we have been and want to be again. It's, I think, for everybody.